The following is a class on the Bhagavad Gita as it is, 4th chapter, text 3 through 6, given by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, recorded in the summer of 1966 in New York.
Saiva maya tirjya yuga bhakta sanatana naktosi me tatha chiti rahasyam vidaduttamam. Last day, we are discussing about the process of understanding Bhagavad Gita. This is to receive the knowledge in disciplic succession, bona fide disciplic succession. It is not a thing. Any knowledge, even material knowledge, if it is not received in bona fide disciplic succession, that knowledge is not perfect. Suppose, if you want to be a lawyer, or if you want to be an engineer, or a medical practitioner, you have to receive the knowledge from the authoritative lawyer, authoritative engineer. Of course, I do not know what is the custom here in India. The custom is that a new lawyer, he has to become an apprentice of an experienced lawyer before he is given the license to practice. That is the Indian system. So any knowledge, unless we receive it through the authoritative sources, it is not perfect. It is not perfect. There are two kinds of processes of acquiring knowledge. One process is deductive and the other process is inductive. Those who are stout students of logic, you know that there are two processes, deductive knowledge and inductive knowledge. Deductive knowledge is considered to be more perfect. And what is that? Just like man is mortal, this is a truth accepted. How man is mortal, nobody is going to enter into discussion. It is accepted that man is mortal. Now, Mr. Johnson is a man, so he is mortal. This is the deductive conclusion. Because man is mortal and Johnson is a man, therefore he is mortal. And this is the process of deductive knowledge. Now, how this man is mortal, this truth is established? The other party, those who are inductive, follower of inductive process, they want to see actually by experiment and observation how man is mortal. They want to study. This man dies, that man dies, that man dies, that man dies, therefore they make a general conclusion, well, all men are mortal. Now, in the inductive process, you have got some defects. What is that? Now your experience is limited. Suppose if you have not seen a man who is not mortal. It's not mortal. That means, because you are going on with your personal experience, but your personal experience is always imperfect, that we have already discussed. Because we have got our senses with limited power, and there are so many defects in our conditioned state. Therefore, inductive process is not always perfect. The deductive process, from the authority, the knowledge we see is always perfect. So basic process is deductive process. Basic process is deductive process. You will find so many verses in the Bhagavad Gita which may appear to be dogmatic. The Lord said that matta paratara nanna think it as Siddhananjaya. My dear Arjuna, there is nobody else greater than me. There is no greater authority than me, Krishna said. Now apparently it appears very dogmatic. Suppose if I say before you that there is nobody greater than me. He's saying our Swamiji is very proud. Yet if a man like me is bonded by so many, restrictions, if I say that I am the greatest of all, that is a blasphemy. I cannot say that. But Krishna can say, because the history of life from Krishna, we can understand that actually you are the greatest personality, at least during his time. It was the greatest personality in every field of activities. Now, knowledge received from the greatest personality, greatest authority, is according to Vedic system that is accepted as perfect. There are three kinds of proofs. According to Vedic system, they accept three kinds. For establishing proof, they take three kinds of proofs. Pratyaksha, anumana, aitijya. In logic also these three kinds of proofs are accepted. What is that? Direct perception. You are seeing, I am sitting here. That is direct knowledge. I am seeing that you are sitting here. That is direct knowledge. Pratyaksha. Anumana. Anumana means just like the children are playing there. We are hearing that sound. So we can conjecture that there are some children. We don't see the children, but we can conjecture, we can think, we can imagine that there are some children who are playing there. This is called anumana. Pratyaksha anumana and aitijya or sabda pramana. Sabda pramana means to take the truth from the highest authority. That is called sabda pramana. Just like man is mortal. Now this man is mortal, and nobody knows where from this sound has come first, who has experienced that man is mortal. But we are accepting this. We are accepting this. By tradition, we know man is mortal. Now you see, if somebody says, who found this truth first? Who discovered that man is mortal? That is very difficult to say, but it is coming down. The knowledge is coming down. Man is mortal and we accept everything. There are so many examples. So out of these three, the Vedic knowledge, they say that this aitijya or the knowledge received from the authority is the most perfect. Imagination or hypothesis, nor direct. Direct perception is always imperfect, especially in the conditions we apply. Just like direct perception, with our eyes we see the sun just like a disc, not more than your plane. But from authority, aitijya, we understand the sun is so many million times greater than the sun. So which of them is right? By seeing your direct perception, sun just like a disc, is it right? Or you take it from authority, the sun is such and such times bigger than the earth. Which one of them will accept? But you are not going to prove it, that the sun is so great. You do not know. You accept from some scientist, from some astronomer, from some authority, the sun is so great. But you have no capacity to see yourself whether the sun is so great or not. Therefore, the knowledge received from authority, actually we are accustomed and we are accepting this type of knowledge in every field of our activity. Now what is this newspaper? You from newspaper, you understand that in China such and such things have taken place. And in India such and such things have taken place. Or from radio message, you understand that such and such things have taken place. But you are not experiencing them directly, whether such and such things have actually taken place. But you accept the authority of the newspaper. You accept the authority of newspaper and you believe that in China such and such things have taken place and in India such and such things have taken place, which is far beyond the range of your direct perception. Similarly, there are many instances we have to believe the authority to take knowledge. And the more the authority is perfect, your knowledge is perfect. The more the authority is perfect, your knowledge is perfect. Direct perception, in all cases, it is not possible to receive direct perception of everything. Take for example, ask them not to make noise. Yes, behind the children.
Yeah, that's
what
the man's chasing right now.
They're making noise.
Yeah, that's
what
he's chasing right now.
Now, there is one very good example. Now, if somebody wants to know who is my father, and how he can know, there is no possibility of direct perception to know the Father. It is not possible. Then, who is the authority? The mother is the authority. When the mother says, "My dear son, here is your father," we have to accept it. If you say, "No, I don't believe you, mother," then you have no other source of knowledge. Who is your father? You have no other alternative. Except you have the authority of your mother, you cannot know who is your father. Because he was your father before your birth. So how you can have direct perception? It is not possible. So many things there are. The direct perception is not possible. Therefore, in the basic process of knowledge, the authority has been accepted as the perfect source of knowledge. Now here is Krishna, the direct, highest authority. Matta paratara nannat asti kinti dasti dhananjaya. The Lord says that there is no other superior personality than me. And it has been accepted by great scholars. Otherwise, why Dr. Radha Krishna would take so much trouble for commenting or reading Bhagavad Gita? Why there are so many foreign scholars also in America, in England, in France, in Japan? Because it is an authority. So then we have to accept. We accept, if we do not accept Krishna, the supreme authority, and do not take his words as they are, then we cannot derive any benefit. It is not dogmatic. It is actually fact. It is not dogmatic. If you study scrutinizingly what Krishna says, you will find it is right. You will find it, and if you take, if you follow, can you not ask? If you take it, accept it as it is, as Krishna says, then actually it is as beneficial. and great stalwart scholars, guys like Ramanujacharya, Santaracharya, Madhvacharya in India, they have accepted Krishna as the supreme authority. Even Santaracharya, who has got a different opinion from the personality of Godhead. Because we the Vaishnavas, we accept the personal Godhead. But there are other philosophers who do not accept the personal feature of the Supreme Absolute Truth. Santaracharya was the head of this impersonal school. Still, he has admitted in his commentation of Bhagavad Gita that Sa Krishna Sang Bhagavan, oh, Krishna is the Supreme Lord. He is the Supreme Lord. So Krishna is the Supreme Lord and it is accepted. Now Sri Krishna says that this Bhagavad Gita, this science of Bhagavad Gita was first spoken by me to the Sun God. Sun God. So whatever I am speaking to you, Arjuna, it is not a new thing. Vedic knowledge, whatever Vedic knowledge you know, it is nothing like some discovery of knowledge. No. Everything is old, revealed knowledge. Everything is old, revealed knowledge. Going on, just like history repeats itself. Summer season. It is no newcomer. The summer season comes, you know, in your life. The summer season came last year, and again it has come. And we can foretell also that in the month of December there will be winter season. It is not foretelling. It is going on like that, sir. So everything is rotating. History is repeating. So knowledge, whatever knowledge is there, that is not a new thing. It is all old. So Krishna says, Sa eva ayam te adhya yoga prakta puratana. Puratana means the old. Puratana. I am speaking to you, this yoga system, this Krishna consciousness, this Bhagavad Gita yoga system is Krishna consciousness. All has to be in Krishna consciousness, this yoga system. So he says, Sarivan, I am speaking to you again that oldest knowledge of Bhagavad Yoga, Bhagavad Gita. I am not speaking to you something new. Now you can understand that Bhagavad Gita was first spoken to the Sun God, and we have calculated to the Krishna speaking to Sun God, even accepting. It comes to some 40 million of years before it was spoken. You have to believe it. The 40 million of years before it was spoken first. And we do not know how many millions of years it was spoken again before that also. Because history is repeating. And we do not know. Our fund of knowledge is very poor. We cannot present history of this present world more than 3,000 years. But in the Vedic scripture we find history millions and millions of years. That is the nature of Vedic scripture. So because we cannot find out in the modern day 3,000, more than 3,000 years of chronological history, that does not mean that there was no history before and there was no historical incident there. No. That we should not conclude in that way. The Krishna said that I am speaking to you, Sahibaham Mayatidya, what I am speaking to you now, today, it is not new. It was spoken long, long before. It is that oldest system of yoga I am speaking to you. Bhaktosi, of course it is. And why I am speaking to you, this is the point to be noted. Of course, this Bhagavad Gita Yoga is to be understood by a person who is a bhakta, who is a devotee of Krishna. Nobody can understand it. Of course, may Sathachiti, Yahasam, because there is a mystery of Krishna consciousness, which is impossible to be adopted by a person who is not a devotee. That is the qualification. To understand, to become Krishna consciousness, it is rather a difficult job. Because unless one is a devotee of Lord Krishna, it will be a difficult problem. This very word, it suggests bhaktosi, that one's qualification must be that he is devotee of Krishna, so that he can understand Bhagavad Gita. Now, the Arjuna says that, why Arjuna? Anyone can say, well, Krishna is a historical personality of Mahabharata. How it is possible that he spoke to sun god 40 million of years before? This is something wonderful. How can you believe? Suppose if I say that I gave a speech in the sun planet on 40 million of years before, you laugh, but Swamiji is saying some nonsense. 40 million of before he spoke, that is Bhagavad Gita, in the sun planet. But that is not the case with Krishna, because he is the personality of Godhead. My case is different. If I say, you can disbelieve it. But when Krishna says, he cannot disbelieve it. So even if you believe it, or do not believe it, that position is being cleared by Arjuna. Because Arjuna knew it perfectly well, that it is quite possible by Krishna to speak certain such things. 40 million of before, because he is the Supreme Personality of God. But for others who will hear this Bhagavad Gita in future, for them he is making the point clear and asking Krishna, Aparam bhavato janma param janama vivasvataha. My dear Krishna, you are born you are contemporary of mine, me. Say 8 years or 9 years before you are born, along with me, your age and mine is practically the same. How it is possible that 40 million of years before you spoke to sun god? Just see, it is very intelligent question by Arjuna, so that the point may be clear in future. People may not misunderstand Krishna. Aparana bhavato janma param janma vivasata. Vivasata means the sun god. Sun planet was created some hundreds of millions of years before, and you say that you say to sun god. How is it possible? Because you are born not even 100 years completed. Kathameta vijanyam tamadu prokmaniti. Then how I am to understand it that you spoke formally to sun god? It is very intelligent question. It is very intelligent question. Now what Krishna answers? The Bhagavan Uvacha. Now, and he particularly says that Bhagavan Uvacha, the personality of God, is saying. What does he say? Bahuni ne vratitani janmani tamacharjana Tani aham veda sarvani natam bhitya parantapa. Now, Krishna says, my dear Arjuna, yes, your question is very intelligent question, that you are asking me, how it is possible that 40 millions of years before I spoke this science of Bhagavad Gita to the Sun God, yes. But he should know it, that Bahuni me Bhatitani Janmani Tabacharya. You and myself, although I am God, I get incarnate many, many times. And you are a living entity. You are also getting your birth repeatedly, so many times. So we have passed all it. The difference between you and me is this, that tani bir, tani aham bir dharmani. I remember what I did in the past long, long years before, but you cannot remember. That is the difference between God and man, or God and me. Our position as living entity, we are also eternal. Just like God is eternal, similarly we are also eternal. But the difficulty is that we change our body. We change our body. Bhakanshi Jinnani Jathavya. Just like we change our dress, similarly we change our body. And as soon as we change our body, Lama, we forget everything. Death means forgetfulness, that's all. Just like at night, when you sleep, you forget yourself. You forget yourself that I am the father of such and such children, I am the husband of such and such. You dream that you are in a different place. Sometimes you are on the sea, sometimes on the sky, sometimes or something. You forget yourself. You forget. And when you wake up, oh, you remember, oh, I am such and such person, I have to do this and such and such. So this is going on. Death means forgetfulness. That's all. Now, if it is a fact that I am eternal, so before getting this body, I had another body, or another father, mother, family, or society, or country, and everything. But do you remember it? And what country I was there? In what family I was there? Sometimes we get news from newspaper that a child is born. He is speaking about his previous birth. But I say no. Sometimes it may be possible in extraordinary cases. But it is a fact. It is a fact that in my previous life, I had also another body. I had my father and mother and country and family. It may be I was a dog or cat or man or God. That doesn't matter. But as living entity, I am eternal. I have my another body. Similarly, we are preparing another body in this life. Just like under the preparation of my previous life, I have got this body. Karmana Daivana Trena Janta Deha Upapattaya. We get our body according to our karma. According to our karma. If we do sattvikam, uddham gacchanti sattvam, those who are in the modes of goodness, they are promoted to higher status of life or higher planets like that. And madhya dishanti rajasa, those who are in the modes of passion, they remain here in this bhulok. And adho gacchanti tamasa, and those who are engrossed in the modes of ignorance, they may be degraded from this planet to another degraded planet or another life or animal life. This is the process going on. So Brahma came that Mr. Such and Such, you have now become hawk for your offensive activities. Now I have come to deliver you. Please come with me. Now the hawk says, oh, I cannot go with you. I cannot do it. Oh, I have got so many responsibilities. I have got my children. I have got my wife. I have got my country. I have got my society. The hawk.
So, even you offer the hawk to take him to the heaven, he will refuse. Oh, I have got so much. This is called forgetting. This is called forgetting. Now, the Lord Krishna comes. So, what you are nonsense doing this material work? Sarodharman paritajyamamekam saranam bhavi. Come to me. I give you all protection. Sure. I don't believe you, sir. I have a more important business here. I don't believe you. This is our business. This is our position. Forgetful. A cognizant soul is forgetful. Prakhe pagita bhikhi vasuta. There are two forces of nature is acting upon us, by which we decide something that with now this life I shall make spiritual advancement. Now it is decided. At next moment, the illusory maya, illusory energy, says, what nonsense spiritual life you are going through. Just enjoy this here. You have got so many enjoyments. Why you are doing this? So prakhe vasnika, bhikhe vasnika. This is going on. So forgetfulness. So that is the difference between God and man. Yes. In the Bhagavad Gita it is clearly said that my dear Arjuna, you also had many births. You are also, because you are constant companion of me, so whenever I take incarnation in the any planet, so you are also with me. So when I took incarnation in the sun planet and I spoke this Bhagavad Gita to sun god, you are also present with me. But unfortunately you have forgotten. Because you are a living being. And I am the Supreme Lord. That is the difference between the Supreme Lord. I cannot remember. Forgetfulness is my nature. Now you cannot say. Now, just now it is 8 o'clock. Can you say exactly at 8 o'clock what you had been doing in the morning or yesterday, this evening? Oh, you have to remember. I cannot remember even what I was doing 12 hours before or 24 hours before. Oh, what I can remember of what was going on in my previous life. It is not possible. Another thing is that why Krishna can remember and why you cannot remember. What is that? Why is this difference? The difference is that Krishna does not change his body. You find in this chapter you find that Krishna says, Jada jada hi dharmasya jnani bhavati bhārata puritranāya sādhanām vināśāya dhrishkitāna dharma sanasthapanā sāyata samavāni Atmāya. Atmāya means he comes down as he is. He does not change his body. But we are conditioned soul, we change our body. That is the difference. And because we change our body, we forget everything. That is the difference. Sanyahana Sarvani, Krishna says that I remember whatever has been done in my previous incarnation, millions and millions of years before, I can remember them. I know past, future, present. Not only past, future, present of my activities, but past, future, present of everyone's activities. You'll find Vedam Sarvamitam, the 10th chapter, you'll find that he knows of past, present, and in Srimad Bhagavatam, you'll find that the definition of the Supreme Law is given as sarvajna. Sarvajna. Sarvajna means one who knows everything, past, present, future, everything.
Krishna. That is the qualification of Mr. Krishna, Sarvajna. We are not Sarvajna. Even as the most perfect living entity, just like Brahma, Shiva, they are also not Sarvajna. The Sarvajna is only Vishnu, Krishna. Krishna is Sarvajna. So that is the difference between man and God, or living entity and the Supreme Absolute Personality of God. He knows. He knows. Here it is distinct. If you have to believe Bhagavad Gita, then distinct and you have to believe, you have to say. You cannot say that there is no difference between me and Krishna. No, there is difference. Here the difference is clearly explained. That is the difference between you and me, that you forget, you cannot remember all the incidences of your life, past, present and future, but I can remember. That is. Now, the next question is that if he does not change his body, why he takes as in, comes as incarnation? These are very difficult questions. There come many different opinions among the philosophers. Somebody says that Krishna assumes the material body when he comes. No, he doesn't assume the material body like us. Then he could not remember. Just here is a critical point. If you would have accepted material body like us, then he could not remember, because we have got this material body, and due to this material body and change, we cannot remember anything. Therefore, the natural conclusion is that he does not change his body. In the next verse, he says, Ajopisan abhyatma bhutanami surupisan prakitiṁ sām adhiskāya sambhavāmi atmāyana. Now, this is called, as we generally call, God is Almighty, all-powerful. Now here, the all-powerfulness is expressed. The Ajopi, although I have no birth, I am eternal. Similarly, the living entity, he has also no birth. This birth, which is considered as my birth. This is the birth of this body. I am also Aja. Not that I was born at a certain time and I shall die at that time. The birth and death which we have accepted, it is due to this body. But I am not this body. That point we have already discussed. That I am not this body. So our birth and death calculation is on account of this body. Otherwise, we are as good as Krishna. As Krishna is Aja. He never takes birth or never dies. There is no birth and death for Krishna. Similarly, we, living entities, we have also no birth and death. We are also eternal. But why this birth and death? This birth and death is due to my, this material body. So as soon as we get our original spiritual body and get out of the contamination of this material body, then we shall be as good as Krishna. That is the whole process. You understand? So we have to, this Krishna consciousness means that by the process of Krishna consciousness, we shall revive our original spiritual body. And when we revive our original spiritual body, Satchidananda Vigraha, Sat Chit Ananda, that is the formation of Krishna, and that is our formation. Sat means Chitananda. Chit means full knowledge. Eternal full knowledge and Ananda. Ananda means bliss. Now we can make distinction from the spiritual body and the material body. It is big that
as the description of the spiritual body is given, that is ananda, eternal, full of knowledge and blissful. So just the opposite number is this material body. It is neither soft, nor cheap, nor hard. It is not soft. Soft means eternal. Now this body is not eternal. Antavatti nidiha. And we have already discussed that this body is perishable. Whereas the person who is occupying this body, he is imperishable. So this body is perishable. Therefore it is not soft. And it is full of ignorance. Therefore it is not cheap. And because full of ignorance and because it is temporary, therefore we have got misery. That's why we are feeling too hot. Today the temperature is very high. Why we are feeling? Because due to this body. Matra sparsha sukhaunti asitasna sukhadukkhara. Similarly, in the month of December, you shall feel serious cold. Why? Due to this body. As soon as you get spiritual body, you don't feel, you are unaffected by any material action. You will find that there are many sages and saints who are almost spiritually realized so don't care for all these heat and cold. You still will find if you happen to go to Allahabad in the month of December, there is a fair, all sadhus come there. In the severe cold, of course not so cold as in your country, but still sometimes it is 40 degree temperature. But we find many saints there, bare and the body, there is no dress, they are sitting, dead of mind. They don't care for cold or heat, you see. Because they are spiritually advanced. So as you make your progress spiritually, as you become hot, just like I have given several times the example, the iron put into the fire, it gets warmer, and becomes red hot. And as soon as it is red hot, it is no longer iron, it is fire. The iron, wherever it is touched, it is burned, because it has got the quality of fire. Similarly, even if you are in this body, material form, if you advance yourself in spiritual consciousness or Krishna consciousness, you will be spiritualized, your body will be spiritualized. You will no more be affected by this material contact. The more you make advance, you will feel. Tattattham avaramam dharma. It is not for future tasting, but you will understand. So we have to make our progress in that way. Now here Krishna says that although I am aja, ajo-visanna-vyatma bhutanam-isharudhisan pratyinsam-adhikkaya-sambhavani-asumaya. Just like Krishna's birth, Krishna's appearance and disappearance is just like the sun. Now sun in the morning will see that it appears as if it is born from the eastern horizon. So, it is not born. The sun is always in the sky. It is the position of the earth in which we understand that sun is now rising from the eastern horizon. He is neither rising nor he is dipping into the sea. The sun is as it is in its position, but due to the position, changing position of this heart, we see that the sun is rising and the sun is setting. Similarly, the Krishna, when he comes as incarnation, he comes just like this, in the same way. There is some historical, I mean the calculation, when Krishna comes on this heart, it is calculated that 864 crores of years after he comes once, just like you can
see the sun rising after 12 hours, after 24 hours. The morning sun rising takes place every 24 hours. The sun setting also takes place every 24 hours. Similarly, there is also time limit that is mentioned when Krishna comes. When Krishna rises, he is rising just like sun. Sun set and sun rising is going on every moment. Every moment. Now if you inquire, where is now sunset on sunrise, you can understand. In different countries, somewhere the sun is now rising. Now in America, the sun set, and in India it is rising. Right. Exactly it is now 8, quarter past 8. And if you know by radio message what is the time in India, you will find that it is quarter past 8 in the morning and the sun has just risen. But here the sun set and the sun. Similarly, if you inquire from Japan or any other country, the sun is some sometimes in the meridian, sometimes it is the dead of night. So this time in difference is just like going on according to the position of the world movement. Similarly, Krishna's appearance, disappearance, is like that. It is not that Krishna is born and Krishna is born. No, it is not like that. Somewhere is Krishna there. That's like the sun is somewhere. There are innumerable universes. The one universe you see, this is only one, but there are many. You find in the Bhagavad Gita, the ekansina situ jagat. Ekansina situ jagat. These material manifestations with innumerable universes is only one part of manifestation of the Supreme Lord. These descriptions are there in the Bhagavad Gita. So we should always remember that we are reading Bhagavad Gita and we should understand it as it is. We should not make any interpretation. That is wrong. And if there was some necessity of interpretation, we should not think that Krishna left the matter for being interpreted by in later age. By some scholar, or he could have disclosed it himself. He was quite competent. No. There is no question of interpretation. We have to understand Bhagavad Gita as it is. If we cannot understand, that is a defect in me, not in the Bhagavad Gita. So we have to find out the defect in me. So Lord Krishna saying, Ajogi san abhyatma, bhutanam suru. Although I am the Lord, I am the Supreme Lord of everything, and although I am unborn, aja, and abhayatma, I have no change, still prakritiṃ sāma dhiṣṭhā, prakritiṃ sāma. Now, you should know there are two kinds of prakriti. Prakriti means nature. In finding, in the seventh chapter of Bhagavad Gita, the Lord says that He has got two, while Lord says in the Vedic scripture also we find, parasa sakti vividhaivasya. There are different kinds of nature of the Supreme. Savabhiki jnana valakya. So, out of many kinds of nature of the Supreme Lord, they have divided the whole thing into three divisions. The one is called the external nature, and the other is called internal nature. And there is another nature which is called marginal nature. The external nature, the material world, the manifestation of this material world is external nature. And this is described in the Bhagavad Gita as we find it in the 7th chapter, that aparayam. Apara means inferior or lower nature. lower.
So he has got higher nature.
Yes, he has got, because he says,
he cannot say that there is no higher nature and lower nature.
There is a higher nature.
Now here,
the Lord says that when I come as incarnation, when I appear, the prakriti sham adhistha. Sham means he is a higher nature. He does not accept this material nature. He does not accept this material nature. Just an example we can give. A very tangible example. Just like in the prison house, sometimes the head of the country goes to visit to see, in effect, how the prison life is going on, or to give them some instruction, some good lesson, that while you are rotting in prison, you become good citizens. Now, suppose the head of the state goes to the prison, and to instruct the prisoner, and if the prisoner thinks, oh, he is also a prisoner. The head of the state who has come to instruct, he is also one of the prisoners like us. So similarly, if we think that Krishna is like us, he is also assumed the material body, and he is one of us, then it is that is explained in the later chapters in 5. Avajananti manu mūḍhā manusim tanuāśrita. Oh, because I appear just like a man, the foolish man considers me as one of them. Oh, but I am not as one of them. I am not one of them. Then he clearly said that I appear, prakritiṁ samadhiṣṭhāya. I appear in my own spiritual nature. I don't accept this lower nature, this material nature. So we are, when we appear, just like we have appeared, in this material world, accepting this material world, the lower nature. But when Krishna comes, he does not accept the lower nature. He comes in his original, superior or higher nature. That is the difference between Krishna and Krishna. Here it is clearly said. Prakritiṁ śāṁ. Śāṁ means own personal, internal. Just like everybody has got some personal affair and some public affair. Everybody. A man, high court judge, he may be, as a public man, he may be a different personality in the high court bench, but at home he is a different person. He is a different person. In the high court bench, one has to admit that person, my lord. But at home, his wife, addressing him by his own name, Mr. Harry. Harry, why don't you do it? There is no question of my lord. But similarly, Krishna has got two natures, lower nature and higher nature. The higher nature is internal potential. That is his real life. So here, Krishna says that I come, ajoti, sannabhyatma, bhutana, isuruti, sar. Because I need not come here. I need not come, bhutana, isuruti, sar. Just like if he is the Supreme Lord, why does he come here? Yes, he does not need to come here. But if he comes here, we cannot object. We cannot object. We cannot say that he cannot come here. He is free. He is sambo. He is fully independent. If he likes, he can come. Just like the example, if the head of the state goes to a prison house, it is not that he has been forced to come there, just like other prisoners. But he comes to inspect to see it is liking. Similarly, Krishna comes here with a purpose. What is that purpose? He comes here to reclaim this fallen soul. We are a part and parcel. We are
Krishna loves us more than we love him. We do not love him. But Krishna loves. Krishna loves every living being. He says, every living being, whatever form he is, that doesn't matter. I am the Vijapada Pita. I am the seed-giving father. So, the father is always affectionate to the son. The sons may forget the father, but the father cannot forget. So Krishna comes here out of his love for us, to deliver us. To give us the right path. Sarva-dharmān parityajya, my dear son, why you are rotting in this miserable world? You come to me, I give you all protection. You are the son of the Supreme, so you can enjoy life very supremely, very magnificently, without any death. Why you are rotting? That is Krishna's mercy. Ajogi sannapayātmā, bhūtārāni surūki san. Don't think that Krishna comes just like we have come here being obliged, prakita kriyamanai, you guys, forced by the laws of nature, according to a karma. He does not come like that. That is the difference between Krishna and myself. Thank you very much.